let's finish this coloring number business. Okay. Now we had a lemma such that if we have a graph whose coloring number is greater than mu, a coloring number of x is greater than mu, and every smaller subgraph has smaller coloring number, then surely the coordinate of the graph is a regular cardinal, kappa, because of the singular cardinal compactness theorem. And so we can, without loss of generality, assume that it is kappa. And then there is a stationary set, S stationary, so that for each element alpha in the set, there is an element beta alpha greater than or equal to alpha, which has at least mu many neighbors, which are less than alpha. This I just recall a lemma. I even proved this lemma. Now, first of all, we can actually assume that the beta alpha is equal to alpha because we just simply interchange these two elements. So we rather the enumeration of all elements into a sequence of length kappa, we just change in such a way that each such alpha is replaced by beta alpha, is the latter is bigger. So we don't have that nuisance that beta alpha is different from alpha. And now let f alpha be the supremum of the first mu elements of the neighborhood of alpha intersect alpha. Okay, so here's a set of coordinates greater than or equal to mu. We take the first mu of them. What is the supremum of them? Now, either f alpha is less than alpha for stationary many, or it is equal to alpha for stationary many alpha. Now, in the first case, we have a regressive function. Okay, so there's a stationary set, and for all elements, there is a bond on the first mu neighbors of that element, which is smaller than alpha. So we can apply Fodor's lemma. Gives that there is some ordinal gamma and the stationary set. So that each element in the stationary set has mu many neighbors below that ordinal. And this is of the coordinate of gamma is a lambda, which is obviously smaller than kappa. So what we have is that we have, and this is the definition here, we have a bipartite graph of bipartition classes size lambda and lambda plus, so that each element in the larger class has mu many neighbors in the other class. Mu many neighbors in the other class. Now, the coloring number of this graph is greater than mu. That's a one-line proof, but I decided not to prove anything because I'm slow. Some people started telling my theorems on graphs, and some other people started asking my conjectures. So I should proceed very strongly. And in the other case, we get another graph where each element is joined into a convergent sequence, a sequence of order type mu, which converges to that element. So we essentially have that there are two types of graphs, so that each graph with coloring number greater than mu contains one of them. The first kind is it's a bipartite graph with the two sides having of cardinality lambda and lambda plus, so that each element in the class of size lambda plus is joined into mu many elements on the other side. And the other definition is the second, what I call the second kind. It's that there is a regular cardinal, a stationary set in it, so that each element is joined into a convergent sequence of type mu converging to it. Now, what we got is that that every graph whose coloring number is greater than mu contains one of these type, and these are graphs of coloring number greater than mu. So the only reason that a graph is of coloring number greater than mu is that it contains one of a graph of one of these types, and consequently, I can prove everything. Every theorem on coloring number I can reprove by using this. If there is a statement, a theorem that if the coloring number of some graph is greater than mu, then blah blah blah, I can say okay, let's check these examples. So this is a trick, and it's nobody knows this except me and you. Now let's go. Now, as Menachem pointed out, we have very nice incompactness and compactness for this. Whenever we have a non-reflecting stationary set, then we have incompactness for the coloring number. You simply take this and draw edges, enough mu many edges going down from the elements of the stationary set. And compactness is available simply if you collapse a supercompact cardinal to mu double plus. This is the main lambda. So if we are interested in the compactness for the coloring number bigger than omega, then something that 2 days ago you mentioned, that it's important that the fact that the coloring number of a graph is greater than omega is preserved with omega 1 closed forcing, which is an easy, of course we take my two examples and we can easily check that. And it is there's no such theorem for the chromatic number, and that's the main problem, one of the main problems for the compactness for the chromatic number, that there is nothing like this. There are examples of graphs with large chromatic number whose chromatic number collapses when you force with something. This is the proof. Okay, and now we get that if kappa is supercompact and we collapse kappa to omega 2 with the Levi collapse, then we have a compactness for a coloring number greater than omega. If we have a weak form of box, then we can replace this omega with anything bigger than that. So if we just take compactness for one single cardinal, so every graph with coloring number greater than omega 1 contains a subgraph of coloring number and cardinality and coloring number equal to Aleph 2 if we collapse a supercompact cardinal to Aleph 3, plus we make sure that the lemma on the preservation of the coloring number is true by some preliminary forcing. I'll jump over. And there is this this proof of Shellhock, which I don't understand. It's a very tricky argument, but if the existence, if we have class many supercompact cardinals, then we can organize that we have compactness of coloring number for every coloring number. Whenever the coloring number is greater than mu, then X contains a subgraph with size and cardinality mu plus. And this is iterated collapse, plus we do something at the singular successors. Okay, graph theory. Let's do something on graph theory. This is the example mentioned by Magidor. If we take the shift graph, the shift graph is the following. We take the lambda as a cardinal, take lambda, and the vertices of the graph are the pairs of lambda. So the everything jumps up. Every vertex is a pair, and we join two pairs if they are consecutive. So x, y, YZ is an edge in this graph. Okay, so the vertices, the points of the graph are the pairs, and we join two pairs if they are consecutive, X less than Y less than Z, and we join X, Y, and YZ, so they form a consecutive pair of pairs. Now, the chromatic number of this graph is less than or equal to kappa if and only if lambda is less than or equal to kappa. The positive size, namely that if lambda is greater than or equal to 2 to the kappa plus, then the chromatic number is greater than kappa. This is a special case of the Erdős-Rédl theorem. You have 2 to the kappa plus, you color the pairs with kappa many colors, then there are two consecutive edges with the same color. In fact, there is a monochromatic triangle. In fact, there are very large homogeneous sets. So this is a very, very special case of the Erdős-Rédl. If the size is less than or equal to 2 to the cup, if lambda is an ordinal whose cardinality is less than or equal to 2 to the kappa, then the chromatic number of this graph is less than or equal to kappa, basically because how do you describe an ordered set of size 2 to the kappa? Well, enumerate the elements or psi less than 2 to the kappa. And then two elements Now, if I have, so here is some ordinal whose coordinate is less than or equal to 2 to the kappa, and take two elements, psi and eta. Now, there corresponds a function from kappa to 2 to this element, and there corresponds another function from kappa to 2 for these elements, because there are as many ordinals here as functions from kappa to 2. Now, if I have two functions from kappa to 2, there is a first difference, so there is an alpha where they first differ. I describe the way how they differ. So at the value alpha, the function corresponding to xi is 0, and the value of the function corresponding to eta is 1, or vice versa. So I give that information, 0 or 1 here. And I also tell which is smaller, which is bigger in this ordering, because this is not the lexicographic ordering of 2 to the kappa, it's some well ordering. And this is good. This is a good coordinate. There are no consecutive pairs which get the same color. That's easy to check. Okay, so there's... also, there's a generalization of this statement. The general shift graph, when I take the n tuples of some cardinal lambda, so here we take a cardinal lambda, I take all the increasing n element sequences, and I join two if one of them, what is the name for this, is a shift of the other, shift by one step. So the second element of the first is the first element of the second, the third element equals the second element, the last element equals the one less by the last element here, etc., etc. And the chromatic number of this graph is less than or equal to kappa if and only if lambda is less than or equal to the n minus 1 times iterated exponentiation of kappa. But this gives a lot of examples. So we have a graph x of a coordinate 2 to the kappa plus with chromatic number greater than kappa, so that all smaller subgraph y subset of x, the coordinate of y is less than or equal to 2 to the kappa, has chromatic number y less than or equal to kappa, just using the previous example. So that gives an example of a graph of coordinate 2 to the kappa plus, whose chromatic number is greater than kappa, but all smaller subgraphs have smaller chromatic number. So the chromatic number jumps at 2 to the kappa plus, and here we have that the chromatic number can jump at 2 to the kappa plus, etc. So there is an infinite sequence of cardinals where the chromatic number may jump in ZFC. However, these cardinals are not Aleph 1, Aleph 2, Aleph 3, so successor, each is a successor of the previous, but it is the 2 to the power of the previous. This is very bad. I mean, this kills the compactness, the hope for compactness. Obviously, there is no way. So whenever we want to speak about compactness, in the case of chromatic number, you have to state this, formalize the statement which allows this as examples. So, for example, if we want compactness for chromatic number equals Aleph naught, then the least strongly compact cardinal for that can be Aleph omega plus 1. Obvious Aleph omega. Okay, now let me mention a few other theorems. Originally, the coloring number was introduced because Erdős asked if there can exist a large chromatic graph which doesn't contain a fourth cycle. This is the fourth cycle. So no fourth cycle. This is C4 in X, but the chromatic number of X is greater than omega. That was Erdős's question, and because there is a similar finite theorem, there arbitrary for every n there is an n-chromatic finite graph which doesn't contain circuits of length up to some pre-given number, and he conjectured that is true for infinite chromatic numbers, and it is false. Heuner proved this, and earning 100 forints immediately. And from that proof, they generalized the notion of coloring number. So this is how the notion of coloring number was born. And from this, it was very easy to describe exactly the graphs which the finite graphs which must appear in every uncountably chromatic graph. These are exactly the bipartite graphs, because the proof that every graph even with coloring number, uncountable coloring number, contains a C4 gives that the same for every finite bipartite graph. And these shift graphs give examples that any other graph, any finite graph which is not bipartite, which contains odd circuits, can be eliminated with arbitrary large chromatic graphs. Okay, so the two shift graph doesn't contain triangles. The three shift graphs, when triples are the vertices, and we join two triples if one is a consecutive to the other, it doesn't contain C3 or C5, so circuits of length 3 or 5, and so on and so on. So this fully describes what are the finite obligatory graphs. And then Erdős immediately asked if what do we know about the obligatory families of finite graphs. So every graph with chromatic number bigger than 2 contains an odd circuit. This is obvious. So what do we know about what can be proved, that every graph with uncountable chromatic number contains some finite subgraphs, blah blah blah, and here is an example. For example, that if the chromatic number is uncountable, then X contains all odd circuits from a certain length on. And otherwise, I mean, there's no way of even conjecturing what are the obligatory families of finite subgraphs. Nobody has any idea how to do. And however, Erdős had a very clever idea to ask questions even if we don't know these families. Defining the density of a graph. So if X is a graph with uncountable chromatic number. We define a function from the natural numbers into the natural number so that fxn is the number of least number of vertices in an n-chromatic subgraph of X. So it measures how slowly or fast the least n-chromatic subgraphs grow. And in the examples, in these shift graphs, fx is essentially the n-fold iterated log. So for this graph, the shift 2, it is log n. For shift 3, it is log log n, and so on and so on. So these are these tend to be infinity very slowly. I'm sorry, I confused the function with its inverse. This is, I always do. So in this case, with this definition, it is 2 to the n, 2 to the 2 to the n, etc., etc. And the question was, can fx tend to infinity arbitrarily fast? I must apologize. I mean, I'm unable to distinguish this function from its inverse. So. And this was eventually solved by Shalhoub, that it is consistently, the answer is yes, for every function from omega into omega, there is a graph whose n-chromatic subgraph, least n-chromatic subgraph, has at least fn vertices. So it grows very slowly, at least if we consider the chromatic number of finite graphs, but the chromatic number of the whole graph is all f1. And this is a very, very clever argument of Shalhoub. Sorry? I don't know. I have no idea. Okay. Another compactness. This is the Taylor conjecture, which states the following: if X is a graph whose chromatic number is bigger than F naught, then for every cardinal lambda, there is a graph Y with the same finite subgraphs as X, and the chromatic number of Y is greater than lambda. So this essentially says that whenever we have a graph whose chromatic number is uncountable, then we can take the finite subgraphs and put together a very large chromatic, arbitrary large chromatic other graph. Why is this? So what is the argument for this conjecture? The argument is essentially the following, that for in all theorems, or essentially all theorems, when somebody builds up a graph which omits some finite graphs, so I can construct a graph with chromatic number Aleph 1 and which omits triangles and pentagons. And exactly the same proof. Only I have to change. This is a transfinite recursive argument. Add new and new vertices, and basically kill all colorings, good colorings with countable many colors. Make careful, etc., etc. There's just one point. I replace omega with omega 1. I get the same for chromatic number bigger than Aleph 1 or at any cardinal. Okay, so there is usually, when you construct a graph with chromatic number greater than Aleph naught, which omits one or several finite subgraphs, then exactly the same transfinite recursive argument, only if you replace Aleph 1 by kappa, so then you get an example of larger chromatic graph with the same. Also, if X is a graph and Y is a graph having the same finite subgraphs whose chromatic number is bigger than lambda, I have now to force myself not to say coloring number, so many times I use that, then as I already noticed in connection with the de Bruijnerders theorem, that Y embeds into the ultra product of its finite subgraphs. That's an easy fact. Now, all of these can be extended, as these finite subgraphs are finite subgraphs of X, so each factor can be extended into a copy of X. We can embed every factor, being a finite subgraph of X, into a copy of X. So we can embed Y into an ultra power of X. Therefore, there is an ultra power of X whose chromatic number is bigger than lambda. So if the Taylor conjecture holds, then there are arbitrary large chromatic ultra powers of every uncountable chromatic graph X. For every graph whose chromatic number is bigger than countable, there's an elementary equivalent graph whose chromatic number is as large, at least as large as you wish. Oops. Okay, and the Taylor conjecture is consistently false. It is consistent that there is a graph X with size and chromatic number Aleph 1, such that if Y is a graph all whose finite subgraphs occur in X, then the chromatic number of Y is at most Aleph 2. So this gives a consistent counterexample to the Taylor conjecture. Okay, so I sketch the proof. Let's first add a coin-real. So this is a function. A coin-real is a function from omega to the omega, which is not dominated by any ground model function. So first add this, and then use the Shelagh forcing, giving a graph X on omega 1 whose chromatic number is omega 1 and whose Fx is greater than or equal to F. Shelagh does it, so we can do that. We can apply that, sorry. It's not true that we can do everything. Now, P star Q, the iterated forcing has size Aleph 1, but that one has to check it. Now, if Y is a graph in the iterated forcing model whose all finite subgraphs are in X, now every graph in a forcing model splits into as many subgraphs, which are all in the ground model, as large the forcing is. So we force with a forcing of size Aleph 1, and we get a graph in the forced model. Then that graph splits into Aleph 1 many ground model subgraphs, simply because every edge of it is put into it by some condition, and there are Aleph 1 conditions. And for every condition, those edges, which are forced to be in that graph, form a subgraph in V. Now, if Z is a subset of Y, then this function Fy is less than or equal to Fz, that's easy to check from the definition. If z is in V, then fz is also in V, so that function, whatever the Erdős function is absolutely calculated. Forcing doesn't change the finite subgraphs or the chromatic number of finite subgraphs. Yes. Yeah. So I'm all confused with ordering. So what we would get that Fy is bounded by a grand model function, which is impossible, and the only exit from this is that the chromatic number is simply finite, that the function is undefined for large enough values, which only occurs if the chromatic number is finite. So Y decomposes into Aleph one many grand model graphs, each having a finite chromatic number. But if you have Aleph one, the union, the edge union of Aleph one graphs, all with a finite chromatic number, then the union has chromatic number at most 2 to the Aleph 1. There's an easy fact that if you take edge union of several graphs, then the chromatic number multiplies. And so the chromatic number of Y is at most Aleph 2, and we are done. We have GCH. So that's the proof. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah. These are the edges of Y which are put into Y by P. Every element is forced to be in Y by some condition P, so it you mean yeah. Okay, this is just a sketch of the proof, so probably I should have started with getting a name for Y, etc., etc. There's a short description of a longer proof. On the other hand, it is consistent that all F2 Aleph 3, so Aleph 2 is the compactness of this problem, namely that the chromatic number of any graph is at least Aleph 2, then there are arbitrary large chromatic graphs with the same finite subgraphs. So the Taylor conjecture is consistently true if we replace Aleph 1 by Aleph 2. And this is, I don't want to give the proof, only to describe how it is done. First of all, there is a kappa which satisfies this. This is the so-called Hampf number argument. So there is a kappa, so some cardinal, so that if we take any graph of chromatic number at least kappa, then there are arbitrary large chromatic graphs with the same finite subgraphs. Why? No, you say no.
No, I don't see why.
Every family of finite graphs is a countable object. The number of families of finite graphs is continuum. Continuum many families of finite graphs. Now, for each family, either there is an upper bound on the chromatic number of all graphs having these as finite subgraphs, or there are with a large chromatic. So some of them have an upper bound, and some of them can be arbitrary large chromatic containing only these finite graphs. Okay, so we split that continuum many countable classes, countable families of finite graphs into two parts, those for which there is an upper bound for the chromatic number of graphs, for the chromatic number of graphs having these as finite graphs, and those which have not. And now we just take kappa as the upper bound of these upper bounds. So if we go far away, then it's definitely true that if the chromatic number is bigger than kappa, then the family of finite subgraphs is in the second class, and therefore there are arbitrary large chromatic graphs consisting only these finite graphs as finite subgraphs. You say no, yes. And what I do now is I collapse this kappa to omega. This is a surprising thing because this is the first time that I see that collapsing something to omega is useful. This is it's a frequently used technique. And yeah. And then some argument says again that, now in the forcing model, the original forcing whose coordinate was coupled collapses to omega. So this is in the forcing model, there are just countable many elements of the forcing. So we use the same argument I don't give the more details of the proof. So every graph in the forced model splits into countable many ground model graphs and so on. So if we have L like assumptions, then we have many counterexamples. So for example, if we have 2 to the lambda equals lambda plus and square lambda, then there is a graph with size and chromatic number lambda plus, so that every smaller subgraph is countably chromatic. So incompactness, very strong incompactness in L. Also, the singular cardinal compactness doesn't hold for some forcing extension. So shall I prove that if we have some singular cardinal of cofinality mu plus, then there exists a cardinal cofinality and GCH preserving forcing extension in which there is a graph whose coordinate is lambda. Lambda is a singular cardinal. The chromatic number is mu plus, and the chromatic number of every smaller subgraph is less than or equal to mu. Also, this holds in L. So he proved the same thing in L. But this is an interesting question. If there is compactness for the chromatic, I mean The one big question which apparently unsolved now, if there is any type of compactness for the chromatic number. Do we have a reasonably small cardinal kappa? I don't know. The first inaccessible, or I don't know, Aleph omega 1 plus 2 or something like that. So that every graph whose chromatic number is bigger than Aleph naught contains a subgraph of that. Contains an uncountable chromatic subgraph whose size is smaller than this pre-given number. This is unsolved at the moment. And a special case of this would be the singular cardinal compactness for that. And I don't know alone. So is there a consistency for the opposite of this? Every graph with chromatic number Aleph 1, coordinate Aleph omega 1 contains a smaller subgraph of chromatic number Aleph 1. Okay, so this is, a specialist of how to collapse large cardinals to singular cardinals, and maybe that works. Although that's probably won't solve the original problem. So that's maybe this misleading. And right, surprise. Okay, so as somebody mentioned that now the whole question becomes a two-parameter question, the chromatic number and the cardinality. It was already raised. So can we have a reflection at least if we use also the cardinality? And the Forman-Leber theorem is an example of this. It is consistent from a huge cardinal that every graph with size and chromatic number LF2 contains a subgraph of size and chromatic number LF1. Observe that this doesn't contradict the shift graph example. We must be always very careful because these are these horrible examples and very simple examples. And this can be proved by very strong ideas. Almost all the proofs which I have seen of this type, some type of reflection for the chromatic numbers use strong filters. A filter so that the reduced product of something is small. And that easily gives the statement, except the original proof of the Forman-Leber, which gives a forcing P such that JP over P has a very strong, how do you call it, chain condition. It's the union of Aleph 1 many filters or whatever, and and this is good because it saves the chromatic number. So if we have an Aleph 2 chromatic graph, and we force with a forcing notion, which is the union of Aleph 1 many subsets so that any two elements in the same subset are compatible, then the chromatic number stays. And so this is, so they do have a lemma under certain circumstances, the chromatic number remains. And Yeah. This is your question. So, is it consistent that each graph X of cardinality Aleph 2, which is uncountable chromatic, contains a subgraph with size and chromatic number Aleph 1? So the size is Aleph 2, the chromatic number is at least Aleph 1, then there is a subgraph with size and chromatic number Aleph 1. So for example, every graph of size Aleph 2 and chromatic number Aleph 1, exactly Aleph 1, contains a subgraph of size Aleph 2 and Aleph 1. If this can be solved, then the proof is totally different from all the classical proofs. Because then usually what we do is that we embed, we have an elementary embedding, and that in that embedding, the original graph will be a good subgraph of the J image of the graph. Okay, so X is a good subgraph of JX, and yeah, but this doesn't work here because there's a change. So the size Aleph 2, the chromatic number Aleph 1, and we want a size Aleph 1, chromatic number Aleph 1 subgraph. So this is very strange statement. It contradicts CH because of the shift graph, and it is a very strong form of the formal labor. Okay, so Aleph 2 implies Aleph 1. Rather than that, we want Aleph 2 greater or equal to Aleph 1 implies Aleph 1. So, and I don't know what to do. This is a shallow proof that we can have at least if the cardinality is Aleph omega plus 1. So for every graph of cardinality Aleph omega plus 1 and chromatic number at least Aleph 1, it contains a subgraph of cardinality less than Aleph omega, and the chromatic number is also Aleph 1. Now this is why we write here Aleph omega plus 1, because this is the first point where we don't have this shift graph example, if GCH holds. Okay, so we have a counterexample on Aleph 2, Aleph 3, Aleph, etc. Aleph omega is an obvious case, so Aleph omega plus 1 is the least where we can hope for such a statement. Of course, perhaps the most general conjecture if we write greater or equal to Aleph omega here. But that doesn't seem to be easy. And the proof of this is that we take the so-called first Magidor model, and there is a very strong filter there, enough strong that we can fuse many partial colorings, partial good colorings of a graph into one hue. Yeah. And I think now I finish. Thank you. Of course you have some, yeah. I just forgot. So weakly compact, yeah.
But actually something we could talk about.
Yeah. So your question will be answered.
Well, the supercompact is the answer.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Any other questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again.